sight is enough to make almost anyone's mouth water. Golden brown shrimp, tender ribs,
snapper,
flounder,
broiled in
creamy butter, and all straight from the Gulf of Mexico. The Gulf, it is known for seafood. Restaurateurs who feature the mythical brain food thrive. Tourists from around the world come to savor the taste, and residents of the coastal area will order platter after platter of their favorite catch. But what about the water that yields the catch? What about the Gulf of Mexico as a body of water? Can the public identify with anything but the food they savor? The world is relying on the sea for more and more food, and the ocean depths are becoming an important part of our recreational resources. Some will debate the beauty of the Gulf of Mexico, but there is beauty here. Offshore, the water is crystal clear. There are coral reefs covered with creatures of the sea. There are the artificial reefs like oil rigs and shipwrecks. Marine life abounds here. This undersea world is, for the most part, unexplored. But little by little, the riches here are being discovered. Man is realizing that he has yet to tap the vast supply of oil, food, and adventure that is below the surface. There's a vast potential here in the Gulf of Mexico, believe it or not. Sometime back through history, the name for this planet evolved. Earth, they called it. Earth, because they considered the surface was made up mostly of rock and soil. If only they had known what the Earth was really like, then they might have called it ocean instead. The Gulf of Mexico is a small part of the 330 million cubic miles of water that covers this globe. One might call the Gulf the great sink in the middle of the United States. The Gulf, sooner or later, catches everything. Everything from black mud that flows out of the Mississippi from the cotton and corn fields, rocky debris from the mountain ranges in the Northwest, and even that dreaded chemical waste that flows from the places like the Houston Ship Channel. Today, Americans have started to become aware of the potential that lies in this great sea. We have begun the steps that will correct our earlier mistakes. And with the availability of new equipment and training scientists and others, they are entering the frontier of the deep to explore the life that has, until now, been a mystery. Here we descend to the bottom of a natural coral reef. It is called the Flower Gardens, and is located 120 miles off the coast of Galveston. Here one finds a true feeling of tranquility. Here you scan the vast acres of coral. You come face to face with the inhabitants of this undersea world. This squirrel fish, like many of the different species living here, takes its shelter in the cracks and crevices of the coral. It is nature's way of protecting it from becoming dinner for a larger predator. Here, the four-eyed butterfly dances along, picking up scraps. The fish has a false set of eyes on its tail. An enemy striking at these eyes finds only water as the butterfly darts ahead out of range. Sitting on top of some coral, we find a bouquet of tube worms. They sway with the deep underwater currents. The tube worm is a living organism, an organism that will spend its entire life growing here. There's an odd feature here. Don't get too close, because the worm will contract itself and virtually disappear into the cavities of the coral. In the Gulf of Mexico, you will find other reefs. 30 miles closer to shore than the Flower Gardens is Stetson Bank. The bank is a reef formed in rock layers with shelves dropping off nearly every 20 feet. Divers say it appears endless. A pair of French angelfish move gracefully through the reef. They abound in this gulf. Photographers say if any fish is camera shy, this is the one. Poisonous animals are not only found on land. In the depths of the sea, one will find their ocean-going counterparts. This fish would finish dead last in a beauty contest. It's the stonefish. It carries a venom that could kill a man within only a few hours. A diver may often feel like someone is looking over his shoulder, always watching. The diver could turn around only to face the sinister face of the barracuda. It looks much like a fanged missile ready to attack, but usually it is only curious to find out what's going on. And there are others who like to do a little sightseeing. He found our camera a strange sight in his world. For centuries, man has always wanted to take home souvenirs. Thus, it is only natural for divers to do the same. But marine biologists and conservationists are warning against repeated plundering of collectors' items. On the ocean bottom to rest might prove a bit difficult. The reason? These spiny sea urchins clutter in patches with their sharp spines sticking straight up. Many a diver has had to return to the surface with sharp pains. You might call the sea urchin the porcupine of the sea. Man inhabiting the ocean bottom. It may sound strange, but the dream of Jules Verne may not be that far from reality. Already, the Flower Garden's Ocean Research Center at Galveston is designing and building facilities to be placed on the ocean floor. It will be an underwater habitat where scientists will study the effects of the sea on man, as well as on how man affects the sea. Like the eagle gliding through the air, this gentle creature glides through water. It is the manta ray. Sometimes growing to 20 feet across and weighing as much as a ton and a half, the manta is so big that other fish cling to it, feeding on organisms that grow over its body. The manta is also noted for an unexplained action. It is often seen jumping several feet out of the water. Here we find a stingray. When he is not feeding on the bottom, then he can often be found being pursued by curious divers. Much like the manta ray, but it has a barbed tail. Some divers in the Gulf now report that the stingrays become a rare sight, perhaps because man has wanted yet another souvenir. Cameramen didn't always get the shots they wanted without putting up a fight. A rather independent barracuda wasn't prepared to take a screen test without first inspecting the camera and the cameraman. The natural reefs, their beauty is overwhelming. But the reefs are just a small part of the endless territory here. It's an amazing saga. The Gulf of Mexico, believe it or not. On a calm day, the site of a reef is often covered with small pleasure boats. Aboard the boats are sports fishermen and recreational divers. On the deck of the Aqua Safari, the divers ready themselves for the adventure into the deep. Air tanks are filled with hope that they'll allow 40 minutes on the bottom. In order to ensure safety, a special meter is carried. Readings from the meter will help keep the divers from getting the bends or decompression sickness. This dive calls for spear guns and some other safety gear. This will be an expedition to seek out and to observe the feeding habits of the shark, the most formidable ocean predator. Few sights are more terrifying to the diver than suddenly coming face to face with a shark. On this dive, bull sharks came into the area after a bait of dead barracuda has been spread. The divers here were never in any real danger, although the sharks did make a few passes to check the bait and observe the cameraman. Protection in case of an emergency was provided by other armed divers standing by. Check of the area, the shark came in for the carcass. With a mere twist of his head, he severed a 30-pound barracuda. Divers with a quick eye and a lot of muscle often take advantage of the abundance of game fish in these reefs. Spear gun in hand, the diver sets out in search of a ling. The ling is a most tasty, boneless fish. It may often weigh 30 pounds. A good hit. Behind the eye and through the brain, death comes instantly. If the shot had been anywhere else, then a long fight would have ensued. A ling of this size could drag a man for 20 minutes before tiring. But this prize will save some of the grocery money. It could easily feed a family of four, three meals. Here's a perfect example of how abundant marine life really is. It is also an example that shows how man must use his judgment and keep them from becoming extinct. Catches must be limited. Divers must follow the example of this man and limit what they take from this beautiful hunting ground. Like portions of our society, the ocean world has its poverty area. They cover long stretches along the Gulf Coast. But in the past few years, divers and fishermen have detected rare miracles of life. Accidents have ended up providing reefs. These accidental gathering places on the ocean floor are oftentimes of remains of ships. And here we explore the remains of the motor vessel V.A. Fogg. This 575-foot tanker sank in February of 1972, 37 miles off the coast of Galveston. Since that time, she has become a haven for many of the same underwater creatures that are found in the natural reefs. A complete life cycle has evolved here. These sanctuaries, formed accidentally by man, attract a wide variety of fish. These butterfly fish have taken up residence in this great hulk of twisted steel. They look for food and, as might be expected, do their best to avoid being photographed. Man, as it may seem, is oftentimes a welcome visitor in the ocean depths. The marine creatures often treat the diver as a friend. The diver need only to move gently through their environment. These spayed fish apparently enjoyed having their back scratched by one of our crew. In the Gulf cannot thrive on its own. An increase will only come if more hard surfaces are provided. Surfaces that will provide more shelter and feeding. And along these lines, work is now underway to provide just such areas. The state of Texas is working to obtain 12 outdated Liberty ships from the mothballed naval fleet in Beaumont. The plan is to sink clusters of these stripped-down ships along the Texas coast. They will be placed within 30 miles of the shore, thus ensuring easy access for fishermen and divers. Plans like this have already been implemented successfully on both the East and West Coasts. The primary costs in such an operation come in towing the ships to the desired location. But backers of the plan say the state would more than repay its investment if scrap metal from salvage of the ships were to be sold. The only maintenance after the sinking would be for buoys at the sites in order to properly mark them for navigation. Those funds could come from the State Parks and Wildlife Department and through donations from charter fishing boat operators, diving clubs, and perhaps even from business interests in communities along the Gulf. Supporters of the Liberty Ship sinking plan say it is now up to the public to push government officials for implementation. Underwater entertainment abounds here. These curious triggerfish act like they have discovered something special. Could they be attracted by the diver's good looks? We don't think so. It's more than likely they are poking at their own reflection. At first glance, it looks like these spade fish have lost their way, but don't fool yourself. They are only trying to save their hide. A hungry barracuda is swimming nearby. The barracuda is most unpredictable, and these fish instinctively move away. This is a fairly large barracuda, perhaps 6 or 7 feet, but some of the bigger ones grow to be nearly 10 feet long. Just 6 months after this wreck sank to the bottom, it had become a full-fledged artificial reef. The organisms that have attached themselves to the steel will not only provide the fish with food, but they will also protect the steel from rusting and eventually corroding away by separating the metal from the salt water. Some 60 million tons of fish are taken from the sea every year. Today, man must search out and capture the game. There is no real effort to cultivate as we do on the land. Artificial reefs may be man's first step towards the start of underwater farming. One form of artificial reefs has evolved from another area of technological advancement, the offshore oil platform. The pilings of the platform provide a unique vehicle for underwater life to prosper. From the ocean bottom all the way to the surface, various forms grow. Here the diver can move in a small area and still find a wide variety of sea life. It is a perfect place for the once a week sport diver to go. During one dive, he may find more than he would on several long dives in an area where such a structure is not present. From the bottom of this rig, a large gathering of barracuda drifting near the surface, keeping a watchful eye on our cameraman below. There's adventure under this oil platform. A diver spots two ling, and what follows is a battle that will be told and retold many times topside. And on winter nights when old diving stories are exchanged. are mankind's last frontier on this planet. For ages, islanders that we have treated the great waters as little more than hunting grounds for fishermen, highways for ships. Now at last, we are awakening to see that beneath the waves lies a vast virgin territory, every bit as challenging as outer space and infinitely more promising of economic reward. Man at last has the scientific capability and technical know-how to meet the challenge. Work for food, water, minerals, power, and wealth. Of all the sea's possibilities for man's future, the greatest may be its promise of an increase in the world's food supply. Square mile for square mile, this sea may be more productive than all the land that is currently cultivated. Presently, the ocean supply only about 2% of man's food. Despite all of our learning, man's relationship with the sea is still primitive. He is still a hunter under the sea, rather than a harvester. But all this can change. Man has developed techniques in every field, including undersea exploration and protection. The future abounds with promise. The Gulf of Mexico is yet a small example of what we can find elsewhere, of what man can do to enrich himself while still enriching the living world below the water. Yes, there is a challenge here, a challenge for all mankind. Can we start to use the sea while still letting it continue its fascinating life cycle? We can, and we must, for this is a part of our world that must not only survive, but prosper. It is the Gulf of Mexico, believe it or not.